Dearly beloved, greetings to you all in Jesus' name. I'm so excited to meet you all in this online service. How are you all? I truly believe that you are all blessed, and I hope and I trust you all that you're all staying at home, obeying what our government has said. Yes, dear children of God, these are tough times, testing times, but as I always say, trusting times. This is a time for us to hope on the Lord, stay in our homes and build our homes. And I truly believe great miracles happen behind closed doors. So I want to encourage you that there are going to be great miracles even as you remain shut in your homes, and even as you pray, even as you look unto the Lord, even as you worship together, the Lord's going to do great miracles inside shut doors. So thank you for joining us today, and I welcome all the newcomers. I welcome all our church members and our regular watchers. Thank you for joining us every week. If you still haven't subscribed to our channel, do subscribe and let your friends know about this English service. And thank you for the feedback which you gave last week. Very helpful to us. We're working on it to make the service better every week and every time you log in to worship the Lord with us. And I hope you had a great time worshiping the Lord. All right, so let's close our eyes and get prepared to receive God's word right now. Are you ready? If you're ready, say, I am ready. Say, I am ready. Tell your neighbor, tell your friends, tell your family members, say, I am ready. All right, let's close our eyes. Father, we come into your holy presence. And Daddy, we wait upon you. Father, we wait upon you to speak to us. And Lord, we know there's power in your word. And let that power manifest in our lives today through your word. Father, my earnest prayer is that I will decrease and you will increase. In Jesus' name. Amen. Dear friends, dear children of God, the title for today's sermon, and this is what the Lord asked me to speak, that we are born to build and not break. Come on, say it again. Say it one more time. We are born to build and not break. Tell your friends, tell your neighbors, whoever is sitting next to you, tell them we are born to build and not break. That's exactly true, children of God. Because right now, especially people are locked up in our homes, and the devil is trying to break all families. And you know what? The devil uses us to break our own lives, to break the plan of God, and to also break others' lives. And he uses us. Always he uses us as a tool to break others and even break our own lives. But I want to tell you, we are not born to break, but we are born to build. Not just our lives, but we are born to build others' life. If you believe it, say an amen with me. Amen. I'm so excited while I'm preaching this sermon. Yeah, dear children of God, we are born to build. Now, I was reading the story about a man who was sitting in his balcony on a Sunday morning and he was sipping his coffee. So while he was doing it, he noticed an ant. The ant was carrying a big leaf, probably 100 times the size of the ant. And you know what? It was pulling along. And this man looked at his ant and he was wondering, how come this ant is so small, the leaf is so big, but it's carrying a burden which is too much for it. And he was observing the ant, and the ant was passing on the balcony floor, and it came to a place where there was a crack, and there was another ant waiting to cross the crack partition. So what this ant did, it placed the leaf and both the ants crossed together. So now this man was amazed. Come on, yeah, two ants crossed together, now they are carrying the leaf together. But then when they reached the end of the balcony, there was a small hole in the wall. That was their home, and they were supposed to go into their destiny, their homes. So both the ants tried their level best to pull the leaf inside, but they could not take the leaf inside because the leaf was too big. It couldn't fit into the hole. And finally, after a lot of time, a lot of struggle, and they did their level best to take it inside, but they could not. So they, in fact, dropped the leaf it said carried, and they both went inside. Dear children of God, this man was observing. He was wondering, and he was actually recollecting all the struggle the ants went through to carry this leaf till the end, but not after it. They could not take it along. If you can relate this to our lives, dear children of God, we also carry a lot of burdens. We struggle hard to earn money, to buy houses, to buy cars, to accomplish something in our life, to reach big goals, to finish our education, to come to a place where we can show off to people. And finally, after doing all of this and struggling, you know what? We cannot take it along with us. We have to leave all of it here and then go. But you know what? We can take along the people whom we bring to God. We can take along the people who are saved. We can take along the people, we can carry along those lives whom the Lord has used us to build. But the rest, whatever you earned, whatever you bought, whatever possessions we all have, we have to leave all of that and take only those people whose lives we have built. Dear children of God, that's what the Lord wanted me to speak to you today. I have a question for all of you. Today we have a complaints about many things which we don't have in life. Or probably we have complaints about not accomplishing many things in life. But dear children of God, today I want to ask you something. How many lives have you built? No matter what age you are today, I want to ask you this question. How many lives have you built? How many people say that you have made a difference in their lives? Dear children of God, as believers of Christ, as Christians, this is what we are expected to do, to build lives. Has anybody told you that you have played a vital part in my life? Has anybody told you that, you know what, without you, my life would have been different? Has anybody told you that you are the angel God has brought into my life? I'm seriously asking this question. Have you made a significance in anybody's life? Have you brought in meaning to their lives? Have you built their lives? Or probably, Pastor, probably you're telling me, Pastor, you should change the question. Ask us how many lives we broken. So probably I should put this question across to you. How many lives did you break? With your words, with your actions, with your gossip, with all your negative thoughts, with your complaints, with your attitude, with your ego. How many lives did you break? Dear children of God, you know what? Most of the time the devil uses us as a tool to break lives. Not just others' lives, to even break our lives. Today I want to encourage, the Lord has created us to build and not break. Say build and not break. Even while many people's future are broken here, you seem to be broken. Many people think my life is gone, my job's gone, my family is falling apart, my family is broken. Many people say this, you know this phrase, I come from a broken family. Probably you come from a broken family. But you know what? You are not broken and you are not going to break others' lives. I'm going to encourage you and I want you to be encouraged that you might be broken right now, but the Lord is going to use this broken piece to build others' lives. Amen. Now, so we're going to look at two things today. How can we build others and how can we build ourselves? All right. If you can turn your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 12 to 14.
Now we ask you, brothers and sisters, to acknowledge those who work hard among you, who care for you in the Lord and who admonish you.
All right. Now, we need to care for those who people who correct us and admonish us. See, the Lord uses us to build others and the Lord uses others to build us as well. So if there are people who are correcting you, you need to love them and respect them. You know what? We don't like advice. We don't like people advising us. We like the word advice as long as it's from us, right? We are so happy to give advice to others. And you know, advice is free, we want to give it. But then the difficult part is to receive advice from others. Dear children of God, God has kept a few people in your lives to give you advices, all right? But don't hate those people who advise you. Especially children don't like their parents advising them. All right, children, if you're sitting with your parents, all right, don't cry, don't complain, don't curse me. But then we don't like people advising us. But then the word of God says, if there's somebody to advise or correct in your life, that's a blessing. Respect them and love them. They are there to build our lives. Now, we're going to look at 6 points very shortly. How can we build others? What does the next verse say?
And we urge you, brothers and sisters, warn those who are idle and disruptive, encourage the disheartened, help the weak, be patient with everyone. Make sure that nobody pays back wrong for wrong, but always strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else.
But always try to do what is good for each other and for everyone else. Dear children of God, basically the Lord wants us to be an encourager to build lives. If you look at Acts chapter 4 from verse 36 to 37, it talks about Barnabas. Barnabas was called the son of encouragement. Nobody else has got this name. Dear children of God, you know what? Barnabas did not come into the limelight, but Barnabas was the tool to build Paul. Today we have 13 epistles written by Paul. Today every household rule which we follow is by Paul. Every doctrine which we follow is by Paul. Teachings of Christ is from Paul. How to run a church, how should a minister be, how should a bishop be, how should a pastor be, how should we serve in the church, how to be obedient, how should a husband, wife or a child be. It's all written by Paul. Churches have been established by Paul. But you know what? Paul built all of this, but Barnabas built Paul. A son of encouragement. Did you know what I want to ask you? Are you a son or a daughter of encouragement or discouragement? When people come and talk to you, do you encourage them? You know what happens here? Paul is saved, God touches him, he wants to do the Lord's work. He comes, all disciples say, no, oh, you know what? We know about this guy, we know his past. We don't want to have anything to do with him. But you know, Barnabas said, no, this guy is changed. The Lord's in his life. Come on, the Lord wants to work on his life. Let's accept him. A man was looking at the future and not at the past. Dear children of God, today I want to ask you, has husband, wife, has children, has relatives, has friends, has colleagues, are you encouraging your people? And are you focusing on the future than their past? Are you still talking about the past and say, oh, you know what, pastor, you don't know what's going on with my husband or my wife or my children or around me. I've given them enough chances. I've given them enough time. They don't seem to change. You know what? They're acting in front of you. They're notorious. They will never change. You know, they're wicked. They're poisonous. We use all kinds of these words to discourage. Even if people want to change, you know what happens to your children of God? Because of our words, we don't allow them to change. We discourage them. You know what? Barnabas, a son of encouragement. Today, if we ask people to give a genuine feedback about us, what would they say? Would they say, oh, this guy matters in my life. He always encourages me. He always pushes me to move forward. Or is he a discourager? 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 verse 14. What does it say first?
Warn those who are idle and disruptive.
Correct the ones who are doing wrong. Correct the wrongdoers. It says, teach them. Admonish is to teach the wrongdoers, not talk about them. You know what we do? Instead of teaching people to walk in the right way, instead of confronting them personally, we talk about them at the backs, gossip about them, especially with the current trends on social media, Instagram, Facebook, YouTube. We see a lot of pastors talking about other pastors, believers talking about other evangelists. Instead of admonishing them, instead of teaching them, instead of talking to them personally, what's happening right now is instead of talking to them personally, we talk about them to the whole world. Today, you know what? If you can read your status, we can easily understand what's going on in your life, or what's going on between the husband and the wife, or what's going on about somebody. How will people come to Christ? How will ever people accept Christ if we are breaking each other's lives? Dear children of God, God's not given us social media to gossip, to bash, to break, to talk about people, talk about negative things. No. Our job is to teach. Even the destructive, go talk to them, build them. Second point.
Encourage the disheartened.
Encourage the disheartened. People who are weak, encourage them. Let your words, word of God said, let your words be seasoned with salt so that you encourage the disheartened. People who have lost hope, don't go and tell them, you know what, oh my God, I'm also, do you have sugar? Do you have diabetes? I also have diabetes. Do you have back pain? I also have back pain. Do you think it encourages them? They're already disheartened. Oh, this guy is already worried about his job and his career. He's worried about his mate. Go and don't go and tell him, you know what? Oh, the economy is crashed. Oh, things are looking bleak. Things are bad. That's not the way to encourage. If people are disheartened, tell them the Lord has not given us the spirit of fear, but the spirit of power, love, and sound mind. Encourage them with the word of God. Tell them, yes, there are tribulations, but the Lord will take care. Third point.
Help the weak.
Help the weak. Dear children of God, one of the key roles of the Holy Spirit is to help us in our weakness, not point out our weakness. Dear children of God, it's very important that we help people in their weakness. Don't tell them you're weak in this. They know it already. There are so many weaknesses which we also have. That's why probably somebody is weak in one particular area and you're strong in that particular area. That's why God has given you this balance. Husband and wife, if you're listening to me, don't tell your wife is weak in that or your husband is weak in that. Yes, that's why the Lord has made you strong in the other area. Help. help the weak, not just your own people, but even others. Whoever is weak, help the weak. Fourth point.
Be patient with everyone.
Oh, this gets tough, you know. Every step gets even more tougher. Be patient with everyone. And that's one of the struggling areas for everybody. You ask pastors, it's very, very tough for us to be patient with all the believers. You keep telling them, you keep teaching them, but still they'll come and say, Pastor, I did this again. But then the Lord has taught us. He's teaching us to be patient. So don't give up on people. Don't just say, oh my God, how long should I wait? How long should I wait for this person to change? He never changes. She never changes. I've been patient for him to perform. I've been patient for him to do this, but no, nothing seems to happen. But the word of God says, if you want to build somebody, give them one more chance. Because the Lord has been patient with all of us. And he wants us to be patient with us. You show your patience to others, the Lord will show his patience to us. Next one, it says, do not repay evil for evil. And it's again tough. Pastor, you know what? They've spoken so much about me. I need to speak at least 5 words back. If somebody gives it, I need to give it back. Only then, it's all about attitude and ego. Dear children of God, I want you to say, if you want to build somebody, you be the better person. If you repay evil for evil, that person will never come to Christ. That person will never be built at all. Do not repay evil with evil. And the next one is,
strive to do what is good for each other and for everyone else.
Always try to do what is good for each other and for everyone. Always do good. Even if people do bad, always do. And this is the way we build others. When we talk about building others' life, it's not about going into their lives, staying with them for 6 months, encouraging them. No. Doing good for evil. Always do good. Always and everywhere. Sometimes, you know what? We think we're doing good. But many a times we end up doing bad. We feel this is good. And we feel I'm doing the right thing. But sometimes, you know what? We end up doing treacherous stuff to others. I read this story about a minister who went to pray for a person who was sick in the hospital. And as soon as the minister started praying, this man in the bed started to react. He started shaking his head. He started waving his hands. He was waving his hands. But the minister thought, oh my God, this guy is getting filled. Oh, he's feeling the power. So this guy started pressing more, praying more. And finally, this man in the bed could not take it anymore. He moved to his side. There was a paper and a pen. And he took it. And he took the paper and the pen and he said, Pastor, you are stepping on my oxygen tube. I'm about to die. This guy thought he was doing his best for them. But then he was pressing the oxygen line, cutting the air from the patient's life. Dear children of God, many a times we think we do good, but we end up doing good only for ourselves and not for others. Today I want to ask you this question. How many lives have you built? Do you have a pen and a paper? Can you write down the names of lives you've built? Or probably you're telling me, Pastor, there are no names. If you haven't done so, there are 6 points which says, teach and admonish the people who are destructive. Encourage the disheartened. Bear the weak. Be patient. Do not repay evil for evil. And do good for all of them. Always and everywhere. Now, at the same time, how to build ourselves? 3 steps. To build others, it's 6. For us, it's simple 3 steps. Same chapter, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16, 17, and 18.
Rejoice always, pray continually, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus.
Simple 3 steps. It says, rejoice always. You can say, Pastor, how can I rejoice? Amidst all this persecution, amidst all this virus, amidst corona, how can I rejoice? Especially being in the house with my wife, Pastor, how can I rejoice? Dear children of God, there are so many people who say, Pastor, you know what? The neighbor has got corona. Oh, somebody's there, corona. He's died in corona. But rejoice because you don't have it. Rejoice till the Lord is with you. Rejoice always. Doesn't matter, dear children of God. You know why the Lord says rejoice always? Because your situation should not alter the joy in your life. Your career doesn't just decide the joy in your life. Your car and the house does not decide the joy in your life. The presence of the Lord decides the joy in your life. So His presence is the same always. No matter whether I have a job or a future or a career, His presence is there always. Hence, I would rejoice. I read the story about a man who got up in the morning. He didn't feel like going, but then he said, "Oh, this is the Lord day my Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it." And he went for work. 3 o'clock in the afternoon, his job was off. He was terminated. He got laid. Called up his wife. His wife said, "This morning you said this is the day." He said, "It still is the day. I will rejoice." Came out, took his car. Tire got punctured. Halfway through, he tried replacing the other tire, the Stephanie. It was also puncture. Called up his wife. The wife said, "Is it still the day the Lord has made? Do you want to rejoice?" He said, "Yes, I would rejoice." And he asked for a lift. A man came in a BMW, gave him a lift. And the man was asking, "What happened to you?" He said, "No, today I lost my job. And you know what? My car, both tires got punctured." But he said, "But still you carry a smile on your face." "Yes, I carry a smile." So he was asking him, "What job do you do?" And he spoke about his job and his career. And you know what? The guy who owned the BMW owned a big company, and he gave him a job with a salary increase. And this guy said, "I will still continue to rejoice no matter what happens, whether I have a job or not, whether we are locked in or whether we are outside, whether we have jobs, we will still rejoice." That's the way we build ourselves. Secondly, it says, pray without ceasing. Now, you know what? I hear a lot of testimonies, people, "Pastor, now we are locked down. We are able to spend more time in prayer. We are spending 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 6 hours in prayer." Dear children, I've got one thing I want to tell you. After the lockdown is over, what will happen to your prayer? Those many hours of praying stops, because praying without ceasing is constantly communicating with the Lord. Always talking to them. And the best way to pray always, for whatever you're seeing, pray for it. And whatever you hear, pray for it. If there are any news you hear about somebody, pray for that somebody. If you see something happening wrong in front of your eyes, pray for that. If you see something happening in front of your eyes which is not good, pray for it. If you see something which is good, pray for it. Whatever you see and whatever you hear, continue to pray for it. That's called praying without ceasing. And the last one is,
give thanks in all circumstances.
Give thanks in everything, because this is God's will for you. Give thanks in everything. I know, but that's very tough for us. Give thanks in everything, dear children of God. You know what? When a miracle happens, we initially give thanks for that miracle. But you know, as we go on enjoying the miracle or getting soaked into it, the gratitude comes out. Have you heard the story about this 10th apple effect? It was about a man who got lost in a forest. He was without food for 8 days. And finally, after the 8th day, he found a tree in the middle of the forest, and it was an apple tree. He ran to it. He was so hungry, he did not have food for 8 days. He took the apple and took the first bite. Oh my God. It was like heaven for him, because he did not eat for 8 days. And it was so tasty that he enjoyed the apple. And he thanked the Lord for it. The first apple, second apple, third apple, fourth apple, fifth apple, 5 apples he had eaten, but he was still hungry. He was continuing to eat the apples. The 6th apple, he looked at it and he said, "Oh, this apple is a little smaller in size." Gratitude became less. The 7th apple, "Oh, this apple is not as tasty as the other one." The 8th apple, "Oh, this apple is less in color." He started to grumble. The gratitude failed. And by the time he tasted the 10th apple, he was not happy at all. Because he had 9 other apples, it was 10th apple, and he had more apples. He started to choose. Gratitude came down. Dear children of God, it's very important that you don't thank God only when you experience a miracle and when the love and the joy and the blessing fades away. There are so many people who jump and thank the Lord for the new job, but they fail to thank the job after it's... But fail to thank God for the job after a few months passes away. For the marriage, on the wedding day, they thank God. They're saying, "Oh, this is what the Lord has made." But after a few years, they grumble. Dear children of God, don't just thank God when you receive it. Continue to thank God even when you retain it. So how do we build ourselves during this corona time? We will rejoice always, pray without ceasing, and we will give thanks in everything. How do we build others? We will admonish the destructive. We will encourage the disheartened. Bear the weak. Patience with everybody. Do not do evil for evil, and do good everywhere and for everybody. God bless you, dear children of God. And I just pray that you all will be building lives, not just our lives, but building others' lives. And you will have a very big list of people's lives whom you built. Let's close our eyes in the presence of the Lord. The work of our Savior is to pick up whenever we fall down. And he expects us to do the same with others. To pick others when they fall down and build their lives. Jesus. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Taking my sin, my cross, my shame. Rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb. Father, we come into your holy presence, Lord. We want to thank you for building our lives and thank you for making us builders. Father, if we've been destructive so far, forgive us, Lord. You children of God, if you're praying this prayer along with me, can you just lift your hands and say, Lord, I want to be constructive and not destructive. I want to build people's lives and not break people's life. I want to build my own life. I do not want to be a tool in the hand of the devil to break others' life. I want to build others' lives with my words, with my actions, Lord. And when I come to heaven, Lord, I know I will not be able to bring any of this wealth in this world. But the greatest wealth is that I will be able to bring people along with me to heaven. Father, use us, use us, use us to build people. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, dear children of God. We are born to build and not break. Thank you for joining us. This is live service. I'm so delighted to have you all with me. And once again, I want to welcome all the newcomers. If this is the first time you've joined our live service, I have a request for you. If you go in our description, there's a link which takes you to our website to fill out a form, a simple form. It's very easy. Just your name, your number, your prayer request, because we want to pray for you. And if we can call you, I will call you and also talk to you, or my pastor, somebody will call you and talk to you and pray for you. All right. So fill out the form without fail. And also there's another link in the same description, which asks you to give the feedback about our service, something which you like, something which you don't like, something which needs to be changed. We are open for feedback and correction. So you can fill out this feedback form. And in case if you like this sermon and you want to have the notes of the sermon, it's also available on our website. The link is below. You can click. Download the notes, share it with others, and definitely it'll be useful for you and for others. I truly believe that. And dear children of God, we have our kids' church, which is already online. We have been telecasted by now. You can watch it along with your kids. We have a VBS coming up this week. You will definitely be benefited through the VBS. Ask your children and their friends to join us in the VBS. And don't miss out on the May 1st promise service, which is happening at 6 o'clock in the morning, the 1st of May. Don't miss it out. All right. And if you want to transfer your tithes or your offerings, you can do it online through our bank account or through GPay or use the scan code. You can do it. And you know what? During this time, there are a lot of people who are in need. As a church, we're supporting missionaries, families, the church which we run. There's a church which we run for street dwellers. We support them. There are so many families for whom we pay rent, provide provisions and all of that. So in case if you want to help them, do give your offerings. And also, dear children of God, in case if you need any help, do call us. We are there to help you as well. Pray for you, counsel for you. And if there's any need, God willing, we'll definitely help you out. So thank you one more time for joining us. Let's close our eyes and together let's say, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. May the love of the Father, the grace of his Son, Jesus Christ, the fellowship and the communion of the Holy Spirit rest and abide with us for now and forevermore. And everybody together say, amen, amen, amen. God bless you, children of God. It was fantastic to catch up with you all. See you again in the next online service. God bless you.